Good morning and welcome to the 35th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received no apologies for this meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The second item on our agenda is the first oral evidence session as part of the committee's inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas. And today we'll be hearing from representatives of the Scottish Government and NHS Education for Scotland. For this morning's meeting, I welcome Stephen Lee Ross, Deputy Director of Health Workforce Planning and Development, Scottish Government. Siobhan Mackay, Interim Deputy Director of Primary Care Capability, Scottish Government, and Dr Pam Nicol, Associate Director of Medicine and National Centre for Remote and Rural Health and Care Lead, NHS Education for Scotland. We are expecting Professor Emma Watson to join us, Executive Medical Director of NHS Education for Scotland, and Dr Pam Nicol is joining us remotely, so thank you and welcome. And we will move straight to questions. And I'm just keen to hear how the work of the Scottish Rural Medicine Collaborative informed the plan for the new centre, and what additional areas will the centre cover?
Yeah, I'll kick off with that. So the development of the rural centre is very much the product of lots of discussion around implementation of the 2018 GP contract, hearing and responding to the concerns about implementation of the contract in rural areas. A rural working group was set up, chaired by Sir Lewis Ritchie, to explore that and try to find solutions. It covered a range of issues informed by lots of engagement across rural communities, both within the health and social care workforce and users of services. One of the recommendations was the development of the rural centre, which NES have now been commissioned to take forward. And in scoping that centre out, they've built on that original engagement through Sir Lewis's work and will continue to engage broadly with a range of rural interests, workforce, users, as that work progresses from here. Really, I think Sir Lewis has described it before as hoping that this will be an international example in this space, and the centre will very much pick up many of the issues that Sir Lewis's broader report looked at around recruitment and retention, education and training, research and evaluation and leadership and good practice. And I might hand over to Pam at this point to give a little bit more context from NES's perspective as they move forward on this.
Thank you. Yes, convener. So we have worked closely over many years within, and we're members of the Scottish Rural Medicine Collaborative. So we take forward all of the learning and the outputs from their work into the work that we'll carry forward and build on now within the National Centre. So part of the work of the National Centre is to work in a very streamlined manner, bringing under one virtual roof all of the work from Scottish Rural Medicine Collaborative and a variety of excellent programmes of work that have been carried out across Scotland to address health and care in remote and rural and island areas over many years. And as Siobhan has highlighted, this allows us now to work across all four priority areas in a very coordinated and streamlined manner, but very much building on the work that's come before, and particularly from our work within the Scottish Rural Medicine Collaborative.
My register of interests and that I'm a registered mental health nurse. When I was reading through the work of the Scottish Rural Medicine Collaborative and their sort of final bulletin to members, I was struck by how medically dominated that was. It talked a lot about GPs. Siobhan referred to GPs here, and even the work streams looked to me to be very much focused on doctors and the need for recruitment and retention there. So how are you going to ensure that this does not solely focus on medical staff and widen this out to nurses, allied health professionals, etc.?
I'll just kick kick off and bring Pam back in. So part of the discussion around the 2018 contract was around some of the challenges for rural areas around the establishment of the multidisciplinary team and full implementation of the contract across that. So that was very much in the scope of the discussions around the rural working report and the rural centre going forward. And I know that for the rural centre, those broader professions, they will be looking at that across the scope of the health and social care workforce. Pam, do you want to add to that?
Thank you. Yes, and we are very much focused on the multidisciplinary workforce here. Our chosen way of working is to focus on the rural team in order that we're as inclusive as possible across community services and primary care services. From an NHS education perspective, we've been working for the past 16 years on remote and rural and island education, supporting workforce development in that area, and we've taken a multidisciplinary approach to that in all cases to good effect. And we find that, yes, there's learning from specific professional groups, and what we achieve in one professional group, we are very keen to look at where it's possible to transfer that learning across other groups. But from the National Centre perspective, all of the evidence we have and all of our success in the past, particularly around remote, rural and island education and training, it has been around supporting a multidisciplinary approach, and that's what we'll be taking forward very much across the National Centre work plan.
That it'd be helpful to see some more detail around about that work plan, because that certainly wasn't what I was getting from the reading that I'd done preparing for committee. I'm now going to move to Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody, and good morning to Pam online. I'm interested in issues around how we're going to impact or how the impact of National Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare will be delivered. I suppose I'm thinking about actions, impact of the strategy, the plans. You know, we've had previous previous papers. We've had papers from the Remote and Rural Areas Resources Initiative. We've had a Dewar paper in 1912. I remember Jason Leach talking about Nuka in Alaska, about more community-delivered ownership of healthcare rather than being done to the people. So, and I do remind everybody I'm a nurse, so that was, you know, I remember having Professor Leach talk to us about rural healthcare in the late 90s. So I'm interested in how will NES ensure that the work of the centre focuses not only on strategy development, but also on actions, delivery and impact?
I'll come in again and hand over to Pam. So I guess our ambition for the centre and looking at what does success look like is that through the work of the centre, we see an improvement in the sustainability, capability and capacity of rural and island primary care and multidisciplinary community-based workforce to increase that capacity across rural and island communities so that we're seeing more people getting that right care at the right point of contact, and we're seeing improved outcomes for people in these communities. Pam, do you want to come in a little bit more on that?
Thank you. Yes, and thank you for that question, because we are very aware of the strong history we have across Scotland in addressing and identifying our remote, rural and island health and care challenges. And we are aware that we worked on the extant policy, which was delivering for remote rural health and care, and led on the education and training work there. And since then, over the past decades, there has been a range of very helpful programmes of work, initiatives, as you've identified, highlighting both the needs and the challenges of addressing remote and rural island service delivery and supporting the workforce. In 2008, Scottish Government supported the establishment of the first permanent team, which was our NES Remote and Rural Team, the Remote and Rural Healthcare Education Alliance. And we've been delivering for the past 16 years education, training and workforce support. But we've been very keen to also be able to leverage the expertise of partners across Scotland who have expertise within remote and rural research and evaluation, within the development of leadership skills and good practice, and also around recruitment and retention. We work a great deal with our international remote and rural partners, and we have a great deal of evidence of programmes of work that have been practically implemented in other countries, as well as across parts of Scotland that we want to take forward. So the outcome from all of that is our delivery plan is very practically orientated. We are very heavily focused on specific programmes of work that are now bringing all of those elements together. So that, for example, where before we may have worked on a piece of education and training, but not necessarily been able to back that up with appropriate impact evaluation, practical research into does it work, how is it working, where does it work and for whom, in order to be able to take that across other areas in Scotland, for example, we will now be able to leverage expertise to work across all of those areas in very practical programmes of work addressing the priority needs that the centre has been set up to support. So I thank you for that question, because we're very determined that our work, particularly around recruitment, retention, research and evaluation, will be incredibly practically orientated, and it will be we'll be very focused on getting the results out and sharing those with our colleagues within the workforce as quickly as possible.
Just to come back on that about monitoring and evaluating the whatever's implemented. So for 16 years, we've had a permanent group looking at rural. And so how are we monitoring that? And then obviously, and evaluating, that's what Pam mentioned. But then also I'll just roll in with my final question about how will the centre work with integration joint boards and local authorities to ensure that, you know, the work is delivered directly at the point of where it's needed, which is our remote and rural areas, Fae, Shetland, Tay Stranraer, for instance.
I'll hand back over to Pam. So there is a commitment to evaluate the centre. The centre is funded around £3 million until 2026. An evaluation will take place, I think, after this year two, to look at the impact the centre is making and to consider what the future of it. Obviously, for the initial piece, as a proof of concept, the centre is very much focusing on primary care. Nez might want to speak about, you know, that what broader scope it would like to have. But we very much see the centre as a hub of support for health boards and health and social care partnerships. Pam might want to come in on how they're linking in with those. And that while it's focusing on primary care, the work that it's doing and will achieve, the aim is that will be a learning opportunity and replicable in other settings beyond primary care. But I'll hand over to Pam now.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. And just to follow up on that part, we will be heavily reliant on establishing excellent collaboration with our health board partners, our primary care partners, our local authority partners, and a range of other agencies across Scotland in order to deliver on this and to really achieve impact. From a NES perspective, the first part of your question, over the past 16 years, I think it's reasonable to say that we have become world leaders for Scotland in delivering and designing remote and rural and island education and training and supporting our workforce to the extent we have a happy history of requests for visits from other countries to come and understand what we're doing and how we're delivering it. Still more work to be done, of course. That work has been measured over the past 16 years within NES through our own governance process, reporting to NES Board, for example, and then back to Scottish Government as delivery partners on behalf of Scottish Government for that work. Very happy to share after the meeting today more information on, if you like, the track record that we're building on and bringing into the National Centre, whilst acknowledging there is definitely more work to do, but we have a great deal of expertise already in Scotland upon which to build and to take this work forward. But we're very much in partnership with people within our communities, with local authority partners, and with a range of partnership agencies in order to deliver and have impact.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. Can I just remind those in the room, you don't need to operate your microphones broadcasting, do that. Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My question's to Stephen and Siobhan, please. So earlier this year, I attended a roundtable with the Royal College of Nursing, and it focused on student finance. There was an example from one of the students who'd got a placement on the Isle of Skye, and she'd found accommodation, but it had to be registered with the council. So, and due to housing availability on such a remote location and it being cost prohibitive, she had to withdraw from that placement. So my question is, what's the Scottish Government doing to support student nurses who want to train in rural and remote areas? Thank you.
Thank you. I'll pick up that to start with. So obviously for all student nurses across all programmes, the Scottish Government does continue to offer a bursary of £10,000 per annum, in addition to support with tuition fee costs. There are additional costs. I don't have the figures to hand, but I can enumerate the additional financial support for the committee, if the committee would like, in relation to support with additional out-of-pocket expenditure related to placement activity across the country. There, obviously, that programme of that combined package of financial support is the most advantageous offered anywhere in the United Kingdom. But that is being reviewed in line with the evidence that we're taking as part of the Nursing and Midwifery Task Force, which was commissioned on the back of the 23-24 Agenda for Change pay offer. And that task force is looking expressly at, I suppose, attraction, selection, and also the offers of, the package and offer of support that is available to nurses in training, as well as to attracting graduates to post across the country, but in particular looking as well at, the rural and island kind of infrastructure component that is affecting, that poses an additional burden as well.
Siobhan?
I have nothing further to add to that.
So if the RCN want to follow up with you, Stephen, they can do and share their experiences with you.
Yes, of course, the RCN are part of the task force and are a leading voice around that table.
Thank you. Thank you. My second question is, and this is to Dr. Pam Nicol. In the North East, we're seeing a proliferation of 2C GP practices being run by health and social care partnerships because it's so difficult to recruit GPs out of the Central Belt, and we've got the recent example of Braemar. What's the Scottish Government doing to address the GP recruitment crisis in remote and rural areas of Scotland? Thank you.
Thank you. I can answer the part that the National Centre is doing in terms of focus work around this area, and then I'll pass to my Scottish Government colleagues to give an overview of all of the work that's been undertaken by the Scottish Government to improve this situation. So as a practical example, we've talked a lot about the delivery plan for the National Centre. Some of our first priorities for the first 24 months focus very much on a streamlined approach to improving both the recruitment and retention, or attraction and keeping, of our GPs that we have, and attracting more into practice, of course. Two key pieces of work that we have begun already. We're working to improve support and training for dispensing practices, which are remote and rural practices, for all of the staff within there. We know that that's a considerable stress, and we know from evidence that some GPs being attracted to these remote and rural practices have concerns around supporting the full dispensing function. So that's an immediate priority for us. We've begun work to develop education, training and support packages around that already. We're also working to introduce for the first time in Scotland community training hubs in our practices, and we're very keen to support 2C practices in this respect, first of all. And if I could just explain a little bit why that will be helpful. There is, feedback and evidence around the burden that GPs feel in providing training within their practices, and yet we know to attract more GPs, we have to expose GPs during their training and also give positive experiences throughout their career of undertaking practice within remote and rural areas to achieve a real improvement in recruitment rates. And we in Scotland we've had a large amount of our training, particularly for our medical colleagues, that's been carried out within the acute setting, within hospitals over a long period of time. And we're now working hard across Scotland through the National Centre to develop a package of support, education, training programme, guidance and protocols that will allow remote and rural practices to become what are termed community training hubs, that will then both attract more GPs in training into remote and rural practice, more doctors in training will come through remote and rural practices as part of their training without increasing the burden on existing staffing. We intend to do that across the rural practice multidisciplinary team, so that will include pharmacists, nursing staff, advanced practitioners as well. So that work is already underway, and we've specifically chosen practices to be involved in that and that are geographically spread across Scotland.
Thank you. Just one quick follow-up. How much of a priority is this for you? Is it in your top three priority list?
Top priority.
Thank
top
you.
Top priority in addressing improving recruitment and retention and supporting our existing staff.
Thank you. And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel for attending today. Evidence from Dumfries and Galloway Health Board has described vacancies as a staggering challenge that is on a par with the financial issues. Could you provide further detail on the extent of the vacancies in rural areas and what can be done to attract people to these roles?
Yeah, I'm happy to pick up that question. So I suppose overall, across Scotland, we've seen an upward position in the vacancy trajectory across the principal job families, so that's nursing, midwifery, medicine and dentistry and AHP, since 2019. They've broadly risen risen precipitously in each job family since 2019, although in the last 12 months what we've seen is a drop in vacancies both in nursing and midwifery and in AHP roles as well. What we see in terms of the vacancy position overall is that vacancies typically have been on an upward trend in medicine and dentistry for more of our rural and island boards, Borders, Highland, Orkney and Shetland, although for Shetland, Western Isles and Orkney, this sort of fluctuation in numbers is small in nominal terms, and that vacancies in nursing and midwifery and AHP have been on a downward trajectory for the last 12 months, including both staff in post and advertised vacancies. That's likely to reflect, obviously, the efforts. So there's been about £18 million worth of funding provided to recruit international nurses, midwives and AHPs. And that's successfully recruited around 1,250 nurses, midwives and AHPs so far. I suppose it also reflects a shift in the configuration of job families post-pandemic. It's the trends as they stand reflect also the kind of pre-pandemic pattern of there being more of a challenge with nursing, with medical and dental posts in rural and island settings, comparatively speaking, as compared with nursing midwifery, which is the inverse in our urban areas.
Thanks for outlining those trajectories. Though there are underlying pressures within the domestically based workforce, and certainly having joined recently a roundtable with the Royal College of Nursing, students cited examples of wanting to do placements in rural areas and in islands, but not been able to do that because of financial constraints from their student bursary. Is there perhaps more work to be done to support and incentivise rural placements so that there isn't a significant financial cost that could actually be detrimental or a complete disincentive for participating in placements in those locations?
Yes, so the attractiveness of placement, particularly in rural and island settings, as I was saying earlier, is one of the things that's being considered actively as part of the Nursing and Midwifery Task Force. We're aware, obviously, that there's a financial element to this that's been raised by the RCN and colleagues, and there's obviously also an infrastructure element to this as well, which we've been considering, I suppose, directly with colleagues in the island boards, and looking at the availability of accommodation both for placement activity and peripatetic appointments within those settings, trying to and working with colleagues across government to release funding to increase accommodation capacity. So there has been an example quite recently, I think, in NHS Shetland of the board being supported by government to purchase guest house facility and to repurpose that for the purpose of housing peripatetic and placement students as well. So we're aware that there's obviously a direct financial component to this as well as a broader infrastructure element, and the two need to be considered in tandem.
Okay. And what other efforts are you putting into developing housing capacity? Is it just purchasing existing stock, or is there potential to develop more housing around clinical sites?
So obviously one of the things that we've done to engage in terms of engaging with colleagues across government who are leading on the rural development plan is pick up the question of key worker housing. So obviously not just housing for placement and peripatetic staff, but how increasing housing availability more generally as part of attracting staff to live and work in the communities in which they serve, both, I suppose, local domestic recruitment and also our international recruitment efforts. I think the figure off the top of my head, but I would have to double check, is that the commitment is around £30 million worth of investment overall in terms of the Scottish Government's broader housing strategy commitments in terms of investment in new housing to support key workers. That is, of course, across the country.
Okay, thank you.
Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. I'd like to ask directly about the 2018 GP contract. Was the Scottish Government told that the GP contract would negatively impact rural and island GP and primary care settings?
I'll come in on that. I can't comment specifically on what might or might not have been told to the government at that time, but I'm aware of concerns were raised and that work has been ongoing since through the work of Sir Lewis's group, ongoing discussions with the BMA around moving towards phase two, commitment to continuing to take account of the needs of rural communities. We've spoken about the centre, which is very much the product of that discussion.
Sorry, indeed, we have spoken about all of those things, but yeah. My question was very direct, and if you didn't know, then perhaps Stephen would know if the government was told back in 2018 that the GP contract would negatively affect rural and island communities.
I'm afraid I'm not aware that the of that.
Okay. So, I mean, certainly there was a lot of discussion at the time. So a declaration of interest, I'm a practising NHS GP, but I also sat on the BMA Scottish GPC at the time of the contract, and a lot of noise was made by rural GPs that this contract would negatively affect those areas. And so how long from the 2018 contract, so all the things, Siobhan, that you're saying has been put into place, how long a gap was that?
So my understanding is that the Rural Working Group around very much focused on the implementation of the GP contract in rural and island areas was established in 2018 and reported in 2020. made a number of recommendations, as you've rightly mentioned. We have already covered off the National Centre, but it will pick up of many of the recommendations in the Sir Lewis's report. A number of other recommendations include ensuring that no GPs, rural communities or elsewhere, lose out. So the incentives guarantee, I think it's called, if I remember correctly off the top of my head, that's continued. I think that was about £23 million and has been uplifted since. A range of other funding initiatives to support rural communities. There's work around dispensing practices, which is actively ongoing and will be picked up by the centre, around guidance and training materials for dispensing practices. So the work to continue to respond to those concerns has been ongoing since 2018 and continues to ongo. And as I say, commitment as we approach phase two to support, to continue to engage around what that rural dimension looks like. In terms of the establishment of the MDT, I'm aware our GP colleagues have been quite clear that if some services should only be handed over to the NHS boards at a time when it feels safe, if GPs want to continue delivering some services, we're by no means opposed to that. In terms of implementation of the...
So can I pick you up on that? So, for example, a vaccine delivery system that lots of GPs in the Highlands are saying that they would like to take on, but the Health Board is saying they're not allowed to. Are you saying that actually they are allowed to deliver the vaccine programme?
My understanding is that between the board and the GPs, they can have that conversation, and services should only be handed over when it's felt safe and appropriate to do so. On vaccines specifically, I'd be happy to pick up with my GP colleagues to provide more information on that particular question, if that would be helpful.
That would be very helpful, thank you. Tess White asked about numbers, if I come to you, Stephen. What are the numbers of physicians' associates in primary care in the Highlands, or sort of in rural settings, sorry?
So I'm not directly aware of the number of physician associates working in GP settings in the Highlands and Islands. I can say that overall we have a comparatively low number of physician associates working across NHS Scotland, both in GP settings and in health board settings, and that number is in the low 200 to 300s overall.
But it's a growing number.
It's a growing number, but it's growing marginally, nominally, compared with growth in other disciplines.
And can I ask what the role of a physician's associate is in primary care?
So we've, as has been set out, we've set out that the role of the physician associate in primary care is to support the delivery of primary care services, and that physician associate with appropriate supervision and direction can undertake activities, broad-based activities relating to the delivery of healthcare, providing, of course, that they're appropriately trained and supervised. And we've specified, I think it was in a direction letter from 2016, how we expect that to be communicated and enumerated to patients receiving services as well.
So it's my final question, and I think it's really important about physicians' associates. If you look at some material that's coming out, physicians' associates are talking about being GPs. There is undifferentiated care being seen by physicians' associates who, whilst they certainly have a degree and 2 years of training, that's not what a very senior nurse would have, for example, who's an advanced nurse practitioner who has done many years to be at the point where they are seeing someone. So with the difficulty in recruiting in rural areas, are we in danger of seeing a two-tier health service where people who live in rural or deprived areas are more likely to see a physician's associate than a general practitioner compared to better off areas?
So I can answer that. I don't believe that that would be the case in the context of the trajectory that we're on within the NHS in Scotland and the commitments that have been made by the Scottish Government. So in connection, I suppose, with general practice, obviously there is an outline commitment to increase the numbers of GPs by 800 by 2027, and we've seen record increases in undergraduate medical places alongside record increases in GPST training places, with a commitment to deliver a further 100 over the next 3 years. We've also expanded our ScotChem undergraduate programme in medicine. We train comparatively small numbers of physician associates domestically. There is a small programme within Aberdeen University of about 40. As I was saying a moment ago, we have 40 per annum, that is. We have broadly 200 to 300 working across the service, and we've committed to looking at the role of physician associates along with other medical associate professionals in over the next couple of years by independently evaluating in line with recommendations that came from a report undertake that we commissioned from NES, looking at the role that medical associate professionals can play within and across our health service, and have committed only to, pending that evaluation, to modest increases in training numbers across the suite of professionals.
Thank you.
And Emma Harper for a supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. Just to pick up on ScotChem, I met with NHS Dumfries and Galloway recently, and the CEO, Jeff Ace, said that their retention of ScotChem graduates in Dumfries and Galloway was excellent. This article here says there's 55 completed the first four-year graduate entry to medicine programme, which is unique in Scotland, and my colleagues in Ireland, as part of the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly, are looking to Scotland to learn about ScotChem so that they can maybe implement it elsewhere. So I'm interested in, you know, what your findings are regarding ScotChem. Is it successful? Has it proved to be supporting rural recruitment for general practice across either side of the Central Belt?
So obviously, in one sense, it's a little bit early to do the final analysis because we've only had the first group of graduates. What we can see is that from those 55 graduates, there's been successful retention onto foundation training programmes, and we're anticipating a further 40-odd graduates this year. We have expanded the programme in line with our broad expansion of undergraduate medical places. The intake is for this year for ScotChem was 70, and we are seeing that it is delivering certainly the vast majority of the sort of clinical and preclinical training activity as part of the degree programme in Highland and in Dumfries and Galloway, and also on the East Coast as well, with indications from the students that they're intending on pursuing a career within medicine in Scotland and remaining in the locality in which they were trained at a higher rate than other groups of undergraduates.
Okay, so yeah, that's fine. That was a good enough answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to ask about palliative care in rural areas. We debated inequality at end of life in Chamber last week, so it'll be fresh in members' minds. And the most recent Marie Curie Evidence to Committee, which was actually around the NCS, highlighted inequity in accessing palliative care in rural areas. So my first question would be to ask what role the National Centre could have in making sure that our citizens in rural and remote communities know what palliative care is and how to access it.
So I'll come in and I'll hand over to Pam for some thoughts around that. As we said, the National Centre is very much focused in that primary care setting, but I can't speak on lots of detail about palliative care, but that primary care team supporting that person will obviously have a role, and I'm sure that will be in NES's sights to thinking about how that primary care team connects with specialist services, third sector and beyond to provide support for people in rural and island settings. So I'll bring Pam in specifically around palliative care.
Yeah, thank you for that. So within the National Centre priorities is the need to support our staff to be as skilled as possible, to deliver as much care as possible, as close to home for the wide range of communities across remote and rural and island areas, palliative care, in addition to other areas such as provision of high quality mental health support, for example, and also paediatric care, continue to be, in our experience from a NES perspective, very high priorities and of areas of significant and ongoing need to continually to update staff knowledge and skills with. The National Centre will have the ability to understand what these different needs are across different remote and rural and island communities, working with the citizens themselves through our stakeholder networks to understand where the gaps exist at the moment, how we can work with our expertise within NES. We have existing experts within palliative care education and training who work across the multidisciplinary team already, and our job is to understand where the gaps exist across the remote and rural and island workforce now, and support addressing those gaps in skills, capability and capacity, that in that way increasing access to good quality skilled support for the citizens that live within these communities now and into the future.
Thank you. I'm finding this morning's session very focused on staff, which I suppose is understandable in many ways, but I'm particularly interested in patients, I suppose. What specifically, I mean, you spoke there about, Pam Nicholl spoke there about gaps in services. So maybe give some specific examples of gaps you've identified and how they'll be plugged. I suppose we'd all be keen to see that folk we represent in rural communities are afforded the same choices at the end of their life, and whether that's to end their life in a hospice or to be at home. And those two things will both have unique challenges depending whereabouts in Scotland someone is based.
Yes, thank you. So in terms of addressing the gaps, we work very closely within our remote and rural communities at the moment from an education and training perspective. That's been our history in understanding the changing needs. And there isn't one size fits all, of course. Each community has a different range of needs and each rural team will have a different skill set. So what we have developed is an understanding of identifying those specific gaps, both within the community of where we can marry up what's already provided, for example, by some of our excellent hospice work that goes on across remote and rural areas, and working with them to look at, for example, delivering educational support and supervisory support for staff within the local areas to feel confident and competent to deliver excellent palliative care, for example, within their local area. In terms of examples, if it's appropriate to step out of palliative care for a moment. So examples of gaps we've identified, Scotland hasn't had a specific training programme to train our growing group of practitioners in rural areas who are working at advanced practice level. And this is an area where we expect that workforce to continue to grow and to work alongside the other members of the rural team. So we've now developed the first in the UK rural advanced practice programme. That means that health boards and primary care practices no longer have to take this on an individual basis. And we're currently funding the first cohort of that group of practitioners to go through. Within that will be these priority areas that rural practitioners need to have increased skills and an increased range of skills to deliver
area. Sorry, it's really difficult when you're remote, because if you're here, I'd be trying to catch your eye and not interrupt you. Can you talk to what that would look like for a patient? What difference does that make for a patient, that change and improvement that you've made?
Certainly. The change and improvement that we will be measuring the impact on for patients will be, for example, within a specific remote or rural or island setting where their healthcare practitioner will have an increased range of skills that are increasingly matched to the local community health needs as we go forward. One of the ways that the centre will differ will be using and gathering more data, more understanding and engaging more closely with the local remote and rural and island communities across Scotland in order that we can fulfil that commitment. And then, as we talked about earlier, very practically measuring the impact of that, finding out, asking whether that's making a difference on a regular basis and ensuring that we're delivering measurable change that has impact for patients. It will be by supporting the service delivery, and that will be for us in supporting the workforce capability and capacity to deliver that improved service. But in addition to that, the difference will be in measuring the impact in a very practical and an ongoing way.
I'm going to press, if I may, just a little bit, one final time. What would that measurable difference be? What sort of thing? Does that mean somebody doesn't have to travel to get treatment? Does it mean they'll get treatment quicker? What will it mean for a patient?
Where that's possible to have that increased service delivery, or if that's the improvements that's required, and there are staff within the area that we can support to deliver that care within the local area, then yes, that's one example of what that improvement would look like.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask about alcohol services, because when we had a call for views, some of the biggest respondents were about alcohol services. Obviously, you are aware, as everyone is, about the large number of alcohol deaths we have here in Scotland. So what increases or improvements have been made to alcohol services in rural areas?
We probably can't come in on lots of detail on that, but what I can say is that the Scottish Government continues to be committed to addressing the high levels of alcohol harm in Scotland, working collaboratively with alcohol and drug partnerships across Scotland to understand and help resolve issues and support them in identifying ways to improve waiting times. There's been increased investment from the National Mission on tackling drug-related deaths, and it's been used by ADPs across Scotland to support people facing both alcohol and drug use. In 2022-23, £106.8 million was made available to support local and national initiatives overseen by ADPs, ensuring that local services...
Sorry, forgive me. This is specifically about rural areas that I was asking. So what is in rural areas to help people with specifically alcohol addiction issues?
We don't have material specifically on rural areas, but what's described there will support that rural activity, but we could certainly follow up on that.
Absolutely. So, I mean, it would be great if you could let us know what is available and what increases and improvements have been made to alcohol services. If you could do that for each year that has come up, including alcohol brief interventions, and potential beds that are available for people who want to detox and waiting times. That would be fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you. Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I am quite interested in some of the things that we talk about how we might want to change to a more preventable sort of NHS and how we support that work that we know is quite essential to help people in our populations and communities. So in terms of reform in that direction, do the challenges, are rural challenges different? Particularly I'm interested, we talk a lot about the demographic changes of that population, both the population and the workforce. Do you have some work looking at how we might be able to make sure this still happens in remote and rural areas?
I'm happy to make a start, I suppose, just taking that question in reverse. So what we know in terms of the demographic question that you've just posed is obviously that the The demographic challenge is more pronounced in our rural and island communities, and that's because of the twin effects of both ageing and depopulation within those communities. And I suppose what that exacerbates in the context of that broader kind of community-based and prevention agenda is the total burden of long-term chronic illness that we anticipate we'll be managing in terms of demand going forward. There's a set of, specific things we're considering in the context of bringing forward that remote and rural recruitment strategy under the auspices of our National Workforce Strategy that look at some of the skills mix that is then needed for rural and island working, in particular, where you've got increasing number, you've got lone practitioners and smaller teams and smaller multidisciplinary teams of community-based practitioners. But it's clear also that that there's going to have to be a growing role in terms of matching, if you like, the availability of workforce and service provision with that, I suppose, both national and international demographic challenge we have with an ageing population across the West, in terms of our public health and prevention agenda. And that's obviously a key focus of the care and wellbeing portfolio and the proposal to bring forward, a further suite of activity to consult on, how you sequence that preventative action right from, messaging and public knowledge and people being in control of understanding, their own health needs, but also, dealing with the fact that we know in terms of the burden of disease projections that we will be managing more chronic ill health in the community. And I suppose it speaks to colleagues' questions earlier about, the types of skills and areas where we would be focusing on trying to build up the skills mix of staff in rural and island settings. And that would be in terms of palliative care, respiratory conditions, long-term conditions associated with obesity, diabetes management, and conditions of that nature.
And the development of the National Centre, do you think that will help with looking at that in that way for remote and island communities?
I think there's absolutely scope for the potential of the centre to reach out once it's been embedded, and then picking up that kind of broader long-term cross-disciplinary focus that will be needed on preventative healthcare. Obviously, it's got its four work streams as things stand, and the activity it's already been commissioned to deliver, and some of that is about increasing recruitment retention capacity and also diversifying the skills mix. So there is a natural synergy there, and I suppose there's then a longer term decision for ministers about how the role of the centre could be broadened.
Okay. I don't know, Siobhan, if you have anything to add.
Probably not much more. CMO published value-based action plan last month on the back of its support delivery of realistic medicine. And in that, he talks about every healthcare contact being an opportunity for preventative activity. So going back to your point about, what would the National Centre have a role in and around that, Pam might have some reflections on working in that rural and islands context, the importance of those growing MDTs, those growing local primary and community care workforce, ensuring that they have the skills and the confidence and the tools to be able to drive forward that approach of every contact having an opportunity for preventative activity.
I don't know, Pam, do you feel that is something the centre will be able to help with?
Yes, because it's a really excellent point to make. We're very focused on addressing our existing priorities, but we're also very focused on supporting and training and shaping our practitioners to be fit for the future needs for our population, and understanding at the moment the demographics for a range of remote, rural and island settings, because of course they're all quite different. That is already significantly influencing the way that we're trying to design our education programmes across medicine and across the healthcare training programmes, and also the recruitment and retention work. And if I can give you a little example of what I mean by that, we already can see, we have strong evidence to show that from World Health Organization, other rural geographies, that we the more we recruit from remote rural and island settings across Scotland, the greater the rate of retention of staff will be. So where staff come from a remote rural island area and they have access to training and they have access to good quality support, then the retention rates go up accordingly. So that's work that we still have to invest in and evaluate in across Scotland. There are, if I could say, untapped resources there. We know that we are facing a decline in population size across many of our remote and rural areas, and yet we still have work to do to increase access to ensure that we can recruit as many people as possible into healthcare professions in order to have this capacity to deliver for the needs of the remote and rural communities. So work we're already doing is increasing, working with our academic institutions, working with our training establishments, to try to develop modern, accessible routes into becoming a healthcare practitioner of the future, and also then influencing the curriculum so that it involves preventative care and an emphasis on preventative care, for example. We have areas, for island areas, the Western Isles recently quoted a figure where they have 50% of their school leavers leave the island after school and don't come back, or if they come back, they come back very much later in life. So there are related areas around education and training, increasing access to qualifying routes and a positive recruitment strategy in place where we welcome all people to come and work in Scotland. And we particularly want to increase the amount of people who live within remote and rural areas or who have been brought up in a remote and rural area, who then can be attracted and retained within health and care careers as well. So that's where you get tie into both what we actually train people to do and also who we attract people to become our practitioners of the future, what will begin to have impact around preventative care and providing the type of health and care that meets the needs of the population now and into the future.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
And Gillian McKay.
And good morning to the panel. Given the changing demographics that we're seeing, how can we continue to move more services towards the community, not only into primary care, but into some of our smaller hospitals in these remote and rural locations as well, which are often much closer to those communities than, for example, Raigmore is to Sutherland?
Yeah, so I'm happy to pick up that question as a start. I think from a workforce perspective, and I suppose I speak predominantly from that perspective, the issue with delivering more care in the community is about how we create the enabling conditions to allow that to happen. So I know Pam and colleagues have talked extensively about skills and capacity. So some of that's about in terms of the professional skills and competence, about loan working. Some of it's about professional decision making. I think as well, alongside that, what we would put are obviously how we further improve our terms and conditions of service to promote flexibility of that service offering in terms of allowing staff to be better dispersed in community settings, and also I suppose another enabling condition that we or further two enabling conditions are about how we create the technology or how we invest in the technology and infrastructure to allow staff to be work in a more dispersed way, but also to be connected in terms of, you know, getting support for that collective clinical decision making, being able to use the tools that we know in terms of innovations across the world in medical and other clinical services delivery will allow people to give kind of supported diagnosis and stuff for conditions through advances in AI and other technological innovations, how we progressively invest in that. And then also how we create the leadership capacity to allow more dispersed network management of staff. I mean, obviously there is a service design and a patient safety element to that, and we have to be designing services that are delivered in a clinically safe way. And for some obviously specialist and acute care, that will still require a certain throughput of patients within a given service, within a given locale, for it to be safe, effective and efficient. And I suppose that will be the same, continue to be the same as well for some advanced planned care treatment as well. But I suppose, as I was speaking briefly earlier, quite a significant focus for us will be on creating those enabling conditions that I've just laid out, plus also the focus on capacity and skills.
That's great. Pathways are sometimes opaque, to say the least, when you live in the Central Belt and go to a major hospital for any of your outpatient treatment. When there's those extra complexities of distance in some of these smaller hospitals as well, it's even more challenging to navigate some of this. So what work is going on to ensure that the populations that we're talking about actually have transparent pathways that suit their needs, that means that some of these ageing populations that we're talking about know where, when and how far they have to go for their treatment?
Yes, and obviously that's, I suppose, will continue to be an ongoing challenge as services evolve. Obviously we have to commit, as you rightly expect in the broadest sense, to continuing to signpost access to services and to continuing to evolve both, I suppose, our digital infrastructure and our expectations around how health boards and partnerships and even down to practices communicate directly with patients in terms of their access to and delivery of services, and I suppose that, as I say, that's something where we're going to have to continue to pay ongoing attention.
Great. And finally, obviously, feedback from patients is essential to that ongoing service delivery and evolution. But in some of these communities, the doctors and nurses that they're giving feedback on are their neighbours and are much more closely related to the communities than they are in maybe a more populous area. Is there active work in going out and seeking some of those views from people so that feedback can be taken into account in some of these changes where people might be apprehensive because of that close relationship?
Yes, and we do recognise that. And obviously there are some objective mechanisms for seeking feedback, both in terms of people's experience of receiving treatment to anonymous fora like careopinion.scot and so on. But certainly in the context of our ongoing work to develop the rural recruitment and retention strategy under the National Workforce Strategy, we have, in addition to doing the sort of standard literature review work, done. So we've visited so far NHS Western Isles alongside the WHO. We've done some work, engagement work with staff and with service users. We would continue to undertake some of that outreach work as well through obviously mechanisms we've got ongoing in relation to the Nursing and Midwifery Task Force, also through engaging with service users via our tripartite working structures within the NHS. And obviously take cognizance of the fact that there's a number of individual service users have written in response to this committee's inquiry that we will now pick up on in terms of the next stage of development of that strategy.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Ivan McKean.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. When we talk about remote and rural healthcare, we often look at that through the lens of, for various reasons, things aren't as good as we'd like them to be compared in rural areas compared to the rest of the country, and how do we improve the standard? And of course, that's hugely important. But I just want to kind of flip that around and look at it through another lens, particularly if we're talking about digitisation, remote healthcare, telehealthcare, etc., because there are clearly opportunities there as well for Scotland to get ahead of the curve in terms of how we deploy those technologies at scale in those communities, drive up health outcomes as a consequence, but also position Scotland as a leading player globally in those technologies. So I suppose I'm interested in, and I know we've done a lot of that already, and there's some great examples of that in Highlands and Islands and elsewhere. So I suppose my question is, to what extent do you see the National Centre focusing on those opportunities as much as it focuses on the many challenges that exist that we've already spoken about this morning?
And so from a broader sense, we've got the digital health and care strategy, but homing in on the work of the centre, supporting delivery of primary care services, using digital technology to support that was a feature of Sir Lewis's Rural Working Group report back in 2020. And I know that through its four pillars, digital will be a theme of the centre's work, both in terms of how it connects with that health and social care workforce across rural and island areas, but also how it connects with service users to be able to seek their views, training, support and other features. I'm very much with that kind of international example in mind. Pam, would you want to elaborate further?
Thank you, Siobhan. Just to agree with what you've said, it's absolutely an integral part of our work, both to be innovative with our community members through the work of the centre in looking at ways that we can harness the skills that we've already got around digital technology, both to improve access to services, to improve the quality of services. We already have a track record of pioneering increasing staff and workforce in remote and rural areas, confidence and competence in using technology, both to uptake their own learning at distance. And also we have training programmes where we are increasingly including digital confidence and competence within the range of skills that our rural practitioners have now and will have in the future. So it's very much part of the work of the centre now and into the future. We're very keen through our work to both highlight the fact that often in remote and rural and island areas, they have been leaders in showing others how to use technology really well that we have had. And we want to continue that pattern in using all available technologies, artificial intelligence, low-tech solutions and high-tech solutions to good effect to achieve improved impacts in the way that we deliver services and the way that patients experience that delivery of services.
Okay, thanks. Are there any specific examples where that has been done, deployment of technology and digitisation in rural areas in advance of what happening elsewhere in the country, or any specific plans where that is in train?
Yes, certainly. So, again, our experience within NEST will be in around education and training and using technology. So we were early adopters of technology. So over 10 years ago, we set up our at-distance healthcare education networks, which have been running for about 10 to 12 years using available technologies to deliver education around priority areas of need for a whole range of multidisciplinary staff, for example. We also developed, in response to need, a technology-enhanced learning programme for our learning and development staff within the health boards in remote and rural areas. And that was, again, first delivered for remote and rural staff and is now a rolling programme that they take forward themselves, where they then design for their staff within the health remote and rural health boards, education and training that's high quality, that makes excellent use of technologies that are available and also the emerging technologies now that are becoming available.
Thank you. Have you any further comments on that?
I suppose I would just add that obviously, I suppose in two digital technologies that are obviously already in use, we see further opportunity for in rural and island communities. They'd be familiar to the panel, I suppose, Near Me in terms of video consultation, and also Connect Me, which is actually focusing on well-being. And allows, I suppose, two-way communication with service users in terms of them feeding in information out with a consultation via text message or app about how their wellbeing and how it's going on, and allows them access to a sort of library of services as well. And there's an aspiration to target 80,000 folks for supporting a variety of blood conditions like hypertension through ConnectMe by 2025, and a focus on I suppose rural and island communities in terms of the rollout of those two programmes.
Okay, thank you.
Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Question for Siobhan, if I may. The number of GP practices in rural areas has declined by 7% in the last 10 years, so it's gone from 188 in rural areas to 175. So what is the Scottish Government doing to reverse that decline?
So obviously we've got the nationwide commitment to increase GPs in Scotland by 800 by 2027, and Stephen's already mentioned at a national level we're making good progress on that with record levels at the moment. The number of GPs working in rural practices...
Sorry, it's about GP practices, not GPs. Thank you. If you don't have the figure, if you could let us know and then answer the question. Because it is a massive concern that GP practices are declining. And is that decline going to be reversed, and if it is, what is the Scottish Government doing about
it? We'll get back to you specifically on numbers on GP practices.
I think that would be very helpful for the committee. I just have one final question, specifically for Pam Nicol, and we've heard a lot this morning about workforce, staff, retention, etc. What I haven't heard is where the patient's voice is in the development of the new national centre, and how patient voices are going to be heard in the following iterations of the centre and its development.
Thank you. Yes, we have talked a lot about our support, improving services through our support for the workforce, which is a large part of the work of the centre. The other part that's a very significant part of the centre is what we term our community accountability, and that will be patients and citizens. And we are establishing stakeholder networks. Those will take different shapes and forms, but the intention there is, rather than having sporadic consultations with citizens and with patients, we will establish ongoing dialogue, particularly under the four areas that the centre has been set up to support. So we will establish networks that will aim to be inclusive and have appropriate representation around the table from a range of different communities, north, south, east, west, that will include patient groups and wider groups of citizens. The term we are very much adopting here is that this is a socially accountable, community accountable model of delivery that we're taking with the National Centre, and that by merit requires us to demonstrate how we are maintaining that dialogue, how we are influenced, how we are guided by the needs and the impact that we're having within the communities and so with patients. So it's a very, very important part of the centre. So in addition to having a strategic programme board, early next year we will be establishing a range of stakeholder networks, as we've called them at the moment, that will be completely focused on being inclusive of patient representative groups and of community members, as well as other stakeholders.
That answers part of my question in the going forward. So where has the patient's voice been in the development of the proposals and the work programme for the centre?
Yes. So we have taken our lead from the work that Scottish Government have described that has been in the preparation for the needs around developing the centre in the first place. So it's been a long time in the planning, and throughout all of that planning process we've considered all of the information we've had from a variety of sources and a variety of reports, as well as from an NES perspective, our ongoing engagement over the past 16 years or so within communities, within remote and rural island communities up and down Scotland, have all been taken into account in shaping the delivery plan that we have for phase one of the National Centre.
Sorry, I'm maybe not being clear enough in what I'm asking here. So has there been direct consultation with patient groups, patient representatives in remote and rural settings in the development of the work plan for the centre and what its priority should be? I hear what you're saying about it will happen going forward. Has there been currently?
We haven't had a recent specific series of engagement with patient groups in relation to the National Centre itself. That's within our plan to continue that work. We had established a programme of work for that last year, but had to put it on hold temporarily while awaiting understanding of whether funding will be established in 2023 for the National Centre. So we do understand that that's a priority, and that's what we'll be addressing early next year within the Phase 1 delivery plan targets and objectives.
Thank you. Can I thank the witnesses for their attendance at committee this morning, and we'll briefly suspend. The third item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Independent Women's Health Champion to receive an update on her work since being appointed and the implementation of the Scottish Government's Women's Health Plan. For this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Professor Anna Glazer, Women's Health Champion, Greg Chalmers, Head of the Chief Medical Officer's Policy Division, Scottish Government, and Felicity Sung, Women's Health Plan Team Lead, Scottish Government. And we'll move straight to questions and to Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. And just to declare my interest as a practising NHS GP, Professor, it's great to see you. Women's health, I think, is something that we need to talk about more, and we need to ensure that over 50% of our population have equality. And with that in mind, why is it, do you think, that we don't seem to have women's health and equality running through our NHS as the way that we would really hope it should be?
Do I need to press anything? No. Okay. Well, good morning, everyone. I think it's possibly historical in that the NHS has classically over the years been run by men. And I think quite a lot of the conditions we acknowledge in the Women's Health Plan, that there are certain conditions which affect women only, which are often conditions which people find it quite difficult to talk about. Even doctors sometimes find it quite difficult to talk about. But I think there are other conditions which affect both men and women, but where women are often less well managed than men are clinically. So, as you know, women are less likely to be diagnosed with a heart attack. And even when they have been diagnosed with a heart attack, they're less likely to be on secondary prevention than men. And you have to ask yourself, why is that? And I think it's partly historical, because I think in the 1950s, it was true that it was men who had heart attacks. They smoked, they had manual labour, and people haven't moved on from there. So I think there are a lot of very complex reasons, but we're trying our best through the Women's Health Plan to change the culture and to encourage people to think differently about women's health. And I think we are having some success. I think everybody that I've spoken to, and I've spoken to a lot of people in the 9 months that I've been in post, is extremely enthusiastic about the Women's Health Plan and committed to trying to improve the health of women and girls in Scotland.
And so just on the Women's Health Plan, I was looking at, and there seems to be a very large poverty-related disparity when it comes to breast and cervical screening rates. Why do you think that is, and what work is being done, can we be doing, to ensure that we even this up?
Yeah, you're right. There is a big difference related to deprivation. I think, again, the reasons for that are quite complex. We know that women, and presumably men as well, but we're talking about the Women's Health Plan. We know that women who live in deprived areas find it more difficult to negotiate the NHS than people who live in non-deprived areas. We know that certainly in the areas in Scotland, I'm sure you're familiar with the deep end practices, the 100 practices which serve the most deprived communities in Scotland, and we've talked to the GPs, some of the GPs in those practices, and they tell us that women really have confidence in their GP and are much less confident in going elsewhere. So it's not just a matter of the practicalities of travelling somewhere to get your breast screening, for example, but it's also the issue to do with trust. And so we've been looking at a project which we hope will serve as a pilot for deep end practices, where instead of asking women to go somewhere for women's health care, we take women's health care to the practice. So we're looking at a pilot study where we're taking a women's health specialist, or allocating a women's health specialist for one session a week to a handful of deep end practices to work alongside the practice staff, GPs and practice nurses, to improve their their skills in providing women's health care, to also encourage them to take a more holistic view of women's health care, to see whether this will serve as a model for all the DPEN practices to improve the quality of women's health care. But I think also that, as you know, there is people are looking at self-testing for cervical screening. My understanding is that there isn't yet a validated screening test which has gone through the regulatory authorities, but that should be happening fairly soon. And that may improve the uptake of cervical screening, certainly.
Thank you. And so I just want to take the opportunity to state how important it is for people to take up their screening offers. It really does save lives and makes a big difference. I'd like to ask you, we've seen in the last few years maternity services in Caithness and Wishaw being downgraded, while Dr. Gray's in Elgin is still waiting for its consultant-led maternity services to be restored. So two parts to the question. Are you concerned with the management of maternity services in Scotland? And do you feel if this was a men's-only issue, it wouldn't have had these issues and been downgraded and had problems?
I don't know. I mean, I think that's probably... If I were a rabid feminist, I would immediately jump on that and say, yes, of course, if this was all about men, they'd be being much better treated. I think that's an oversimplification. I think the reality is that if you live in a remote and rural area, there's always going to be problems with providing the level of service that there is in a big city like Edinburgh or Glasgow. So I don't think it's a sexist issue, though in my worst moments I might say that. And I've forgotten what the first part of your question was. So,
are you concerned?
Am I concerned?
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, the maternity plan is not part of the women's health plan. The women's health plan doesn't exist in isolation, so there are a lot of people working on the maternity plan. Whereas I'm concentrating more on, if you like, the gynaecology side of things. So I keep up to date with what's going on with the other plans and other policy teams in the Scottish Government, but it's not something that I'm concerned with day to day, and I don't think I could speak in a helpful manner to you about that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Ivan McKee.
Great, thanks very much, Indiana. Morning. Thanks for coming in this morning. I just a few questions around about the plan, and I think it's true to see you came into post a period of time after the plan was pulled together and launched. So to get your sense of whether the plan covers the areas you think it should, and its areas of focus are correct. You helpfully unpicked the fact that there are clearly conditions that are female only, and others that are shared, and some of the issues that that affect that latter category as well. So whether you think that balance is correct, whether there are approaches in here, and it was quite interesting to read it because I'm reading through some of the stuff around about women want to play an active role, they want shared decision making, they want access to information. Clearly that applies to men as well. Whether you think there's learning from this plan that can be transferred more widely as well, and I've got some other points, but if you could pick up on those first.
Yeah, I'm sure you're right. Yeah. I mean, it is a women's health plan, but men need health care as well. And men are often more reluctant to go and see their GP, and that's perhaps another reason why, to answer the earlier question about why there are differences in women's health, I think that, you know, women go to see their GP with women's health issues, with pregnancy, they take their children to the GP. So perhaps when a GP sees a man, he thinks, oh, this guy hasn't been to see me for 10 years, so there must be something seriously wrong. Whereas when he sees a woman, he's maybe already seen her 3 times this year about something else. And so I'm not saying that that makes people dismissive, but I think there is a tendency to think that if a man goes with something, it must be something serious, because they don't go to their GP that often. So I think there are a lot of things that we could learn from the Women's Health Plan that are important for men. And one of the big areas of work for the Women's Health Plan is to improve women's knowledge of all the various women's health issues, and I encourage you as MSPs, whenever possible, whenever you're talking to your constituents about health, to encourage them to use NHS Inform. The Women's Health team has done a huge amount of work on the NHS Inform platform, and I think it's a great resource for reliable and accurate information, which hopefully allows women, and where it's relevant to men, to take charge of their own health and be better informed about everything that's going on. So, yeah, I hope it's a model for when we no longer need a women's health plan, but just a health plan. I hope it serves as a model for that.
Yeah. So in terms of that core question about does it focus on the right areas, you're quite comfortable that it...
I think it does. You know, it's an ambitious plan. There are 66 actions. It focuses, as I say, more on reproductive health, not on maternity, because there is a maternity health plan. Yeah. And mental health, there are lots of things which overlap, but it focuses on the things which don't appear in other bits of policy. So, yeah, I think it does focus on the right things. And I think we will have learned from this plan when we do the next iteration of the plan, so that the next plan is actually even better.
Mm. It's an interesting comment that women go to the GP more often, therefore they're less likely to be believed. I mean, if anything, you'd have thought that more engagement with the health service would have led to better outcomes, not worse. So it's quite interesting that that's your observation on that.
Well, you know, I could ask you when you last went to your GP, and it was probably... You probably don't go very often.
You're absolutely correct.
Your GP sees you, the GP will take you very seriously.
Yes. No, it's an interesting observation that more engagement actually leads to perhaps worse outcomes in terms of medical outcomes. The plan's obviously got a big focus on inequality, which is great. Although it's then interesting if you look through health outcomes for a lot of headline issues, clearly in many of those... women's outcomes are significantly better than men's, be it alcohol and drugs, COVID outcomes. Even on the heart condition, heart deaths, I think I'm right in saying that men's outcomes are still significantly worse than women's in terms of death rates. So how do you approach that in terms of what can be measured? Because typically when we look at an inequality issue, we would say one group is performing less than others, and the objective is to close the gap. In this situation, clearly there's many of those measures where women are actually performing significantly better than men, life expectancy, etc. So how would you measure success, if you like, in terms of closing that inequality gap in that context?
So I think you're right about life expectancy being better in women than in men, but women, of course, live with a lot of unhealthy years of life, and that's where the big differences are when you compare the deprived with the more affluent areas. How do you measure it? How do we measure the success of the plan?
Yeah, if we've got the plan, we've got your role, how would you look back in a number of years and say, yeah, we've been successful? How would you measure that?
I think we need to do better at evaluating initiatives that we've set up. Mm-hmm. So, for example, with this proposal that we have for working with the deep end practices with deprived communities, we are planning to include quite a sophisticated evaluation. So, for example, we want to look at if we improve women's health care in these general practices, do women get referred less often to specialists? So 51% of Scotland's population is women. All of them, unless they die prematurely, will go through the menopause. I think all general practices should have somebody who is good at dealing with menopause and prescribing standard HRT. If that is done better through various initiatives that we're setting up, then we should see fewer people being referred to the specialist services for the menopause, as one example. We're working with National Health Education for Scotland, preparing a package for primary care for GPs and practice nurses to improve their knowledge of menopause and menstrual health. And we need to evaluate that, and we need to see whether women feel that they're better informed, whether they've been better, they feel happier with the consultation with the GP, and whether eventually, and this is a very long-term thing, the statistics change. But that's quite sophisticated measurement that you need to do.
Yeah, but do you think the plan is clear enough on what those measurable deliverables are, or is there still work to be done?
No, I think there's still work to be done. Okay. And I think with the next iteration of the plan, we should do better.
OK, good. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just pick up on one of the issues that Ivan McKee raises there about what is and isn't in the priorities for the plan? And one of the things to me that seems like quite a glaringly obvious thing is incontinence. Now, we know that this is very common in women post-childbirth and in later life. We've seen a proliferation of adverts and products in the supermarket for women to manage urinary incontinence. Is that something that you think should be in the plan? Is it something that you're considering putting in? Obviously, it's very treatable, and education and information about pelvic floor exercises is something that would help alleviate that.
Yes, and there is a relatively new section in NHS Inform that the Women's Health team has put in on urinary incontinence with information about pelvic floor exercises and so on. So, yes, it's not mentioned in detail specifically in the plan. Of course, it often comes into discussions about the menopause, and the menopause features in a big way in the plan. I wasn't involved in writing this iteration of the plan, and we will have discussions with lots of stakeholders to decide what goes into the next Women's Health Plan. But I agree with you. I think we should probably have more on incontinence.
Thank you. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'd like to ask you about progress towards the priority areas being menopause, endometriosis and PCOS and heart health, maybe perhaps starting on menopause.
Okay, so one of the aims of the Women's Health Plan was to have a menopause expert in every health board area. And we now have a menopause expert in every health board area with a buddy system for the island health boards. We have a national clinical network of menopause specialists who meet quarterly. And I must say, it's a very impressive group. And when I first started, it was a bit of a talking shop with people kind of generally saying, well, we experienced this and we experienced that. And I now think it's a more formal agenda so that we can say we need a pathway on, for example, testosterone replacement for women who complain of loss of libido at the time of the menopause. Can we, working together as a group, have a national pathway? Mm. So I think we're making progress.
So can I ask what... So I'm an MSP in Ayrshire. So what difference does the menopause expert in NHS Ayrshire and Arran make to the women that I represent who are going through the menopause? What have they done for them?
Well, I think if the menopause expert is used appropriately, then women who don't respond to standard treatment of the menopause. So if you went along to your GP with flushes and sweats and you said you would like a trial of HRT, I think that's something that the GP would be able to manage. If that doesn't alleviate your menopause symptoms, or you have horrible side effects, or you're not eligible for HRT because you have contraindications, then I think you should be referred to the menopause expert.
The menopause expert is a clinical individual for complex cases?
Yes.
Okay. And what about the sort of standard provision for menopause support for?
So, as I said, we're working with Health Education for Scotland to provide a module for primary care for GPs and practice nurses to better inform them about the menopause. Mm-hmm. And I think women themselves are now better informed about the menopause, particularly mm-hmm. if they refer to the pages on NHS Inform. Which gives them a lot of information about the menopause. And the Health and Social Care Alliance has done a lot of work on the menopause, preparing webinars for women. So, you know, there are a lot of... The menopause has become a very... Trendy isn't the right word, but everybody is now much more aware of the menopause. So more women are going to their GP mm-hmm. asking, could this be the menopause? So the GPs are feeling overwhelmed.
May I share some reflections from constituents and things? It's not... some of the sort of inequalities and challenges aren't so much around individual women's knowledge about what's happening, but about access to support and specifically, I guess, access to HRT.
Yeah.
And I know in answer to Sandesh Gulhani, when he asked about inequality, you said, you know, it's not all about process, but and forgive me, I hate when politicians do this, but I'll give you an example. From last year, I had to make 25 phone calls to the GP before getting in, then get a repeat prescription, then go to every single pharmacy within not just the town I live in, but the area. And I'm lucky because I manage my own diary. I can do that. I'm thinking about someone who has a job where they're 9 to 5 or they have, you know, an hour for their lunch. I don't think it's about women's knowledge, some of the challenge. I think it's about supply and it's about access to professionals. Have you sort of touched in, you know, reached out to women to find out exactly what the issues are from their perspective rather than from the health perspective and that kind of output perspective?
Yes, we have done. Okay. And so through the Alliance, we've had meetings with women, had quite a lot of meetings, actually, with women with various health conditions. And we've met people here in the Parliament building mm-hmm. with endometriosis, with PCOS. So mm-hmm. we do hear from women. And I think all of those problems that you talk about, not the availability of the medicines in pharmacy, because that's a specific issue for HRT, but, mm-hmm. you know, having to make 25 phone calls to get an appointment with your GP is something which happens to everybody.
Mm. Okay. So that would be the sort of main progress around menopause is the menopause expert, the clinical expert, and each health board. Is that
it's but also working with NES to improve the information among primary care.
Okay. And how will we know that's worked? How will we know that's improved women's lives?
Well, I think we should see fewer referrals to expert menopause services because GPs should be able to deal with standard HRT.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and are there health boards where the way they're set up is not for it to go through the GPs but to actually go to specific women's clinics? Is it the same across Scotland?
No, it's not the same across Scotland. And so, for example, in Lothian, where I worked, we know that in the Chalmers Centre, which is an integrated sexual health centre, there was a very thriving menopause service to which women could self-refer, mm-hmm. which was great. And so we're talking about what in England they're calling women's health hubs, mm-hmm. But which we call integrated sexual and reproductive health services. The problem with that approach is that it does tend to make life better for women who are able to get to Chalmers, who are able to negotiate that sort of thing. But also I think that there's a danger that GPs then say to a woman, just get yourself along to the specialist service. And mm-hmm. so then they stop providing basic menopause care. And so I think that's a danger of women's health hubs, mm-hmm. that you de-skill GPs.
Okay. And you said there's a measure of success would be less women referred to specialist menopause. Like, do you think there would be value in measuring the experience of women themselves rather than... Because
sure.
a referral to a specialist
sure.
doesn't
yeah.
necessarily mean a good outcome for someone.
No, of course. And in all our evaluations, anything that we plan to do, yeah, we ask women their experiences. Okay. We also ask the providers their experiences, mm-hmm. As well as trying to have a quantitative measure.
Yeah, okay. And the other two areas, endometriosis and heart health, is there anything you want to say on the progress of them?
So I think there's a lot of work going on in endometriosis. There's a lot of research going on in endometriosis, particularly in Lothian, which is being funded by the Scottish Government. For heart health, I have a particular interest in heart health, partly because I've never done cardiology and it's always nice to learn something new, but also because, you know, women are more likely to die of a heart attack than they are to die of breast cancer, for example. There are reproductive health conditions through the women's reproductive life course that put them at increased risk of heart disease, and I don't think currently we use those opportunities to try and reduce the risk of heart disease. So if I can give you an example of preeclampsia. Mm-hmm. So women with preeclampsia have an increased risk of hypertension and heart disease in later life. I think maternity services are very good at looking after women with preeclampsia. But as soon as the baby's born, the preeclampsia goes away, so does the woman. And many women don't even get their blood pressure checked at the routine postnatal follow-up, if they have a routine postnatal follow-up, let alone being made aware that they are at increased risk of hypertension and heart disease in later life. So one of the things which I'm looking at during COVID, when a woman was admitted with, or when a woman was seen in the maternity services with pregnancy-induced hypertension or preeclampsia, they were given a blood pressure machine and they monitored their own blood pressure and did their own urinalysis. And that was a very effective way of monitoring women's blood pressure during pregnancy. When the baby was born, they were supposed to give the blood pressure machine back, which about half of them did. I would like to reinstate that, because although that's kept going in Lothian, most health boards have stopped that self-monitoring system. I would like to reinstate that, but take it further and say, keep the blood pressure machine. We'll link you into the ConnectMe BP website, and you'll get a text message or an email every 6 months telling you to check your blood pressure. Mm-hmm. And I'm having some discussions with Professor Bhattacharya in Aberdeen to see if there's a study that we can do where we look at the effectiveness of an intervention like that to reduce the risk of heart disease in later life. And it's not just preeclampsia, it's PCOS, mm-hmm. it's premature menopause, even recurrent miscarriage, where all of these women could be linked into a system to reduce their risk of heart disease in later life.
And do you think that that sort of holistic way of looking at things is uniquely missing from women's health, or is that a reflection of how our health service operates in general?
No, I think our health service has always operated in silos, yeah. Okay. But if we can improve it in women's health, then maybe it will spread further than that.
Indeed. Thank you.
Thank you. I've got a couple of brief supplementaries before I come to Tess White. So, Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It is just a quick supplementary to pick up on what Ruth Maguire is saying about menopause, but indeed endometriosis and PCOS as well. What work do you do, or are you responsible for, when it comes to people or women whose English isn't their first language? How do we support them into better care? And then also third sector, for instance, but also local authorities. I think I counted 7 that have got a menopause plan out of 32. And is that something that you would be responsible for, is supporting local authorities to help raise awareness about menopause, for instance, with a plan?
Not specifically with health authorities, no. With local authorities, no, but with health boards, yes, in that we have now a women's health lead in every health board who's supposed to work with the executives in the board to make sure that the actions of the plan are being included in their work. And I think I'm right in saying, Felicity, that NHS Inform is available in a number of different languages. But I think there was something on the radio very recently about a problem with interpreters, particularly in an acute situation. So there are issues for women whose first language isn't English.
Okay, thanks.
Dr. Gulhani.
Thank you. Just to, again, pick up on Ruth Maguire's point about menopause. So, see, being a GP, I'm lucky enough to go to multiple different practices. And my experience, and something Ruth doesn't like us giving examples, but my experience is that those areas that I work in where people are from better off areas know about menopause.
Yeah.
And they come in having done reading, having thought about it and deciding that this is likely their what's going on. And we have a discussion about menopause, whether it's appropriate or not, and what treatments are appropriate or not. But those from more deprived areas don't come in like that. And I haven't seen a huge shift for women in deprived areas coming in and saying and having more knowledge about menopause. So what you said earlier is that what we're seeing, actually, those in because menopause is now more spoken of, but that's actually in better off areas compared to deprived areas? And if that is the case, how are we going to get the message to those women?
Well, then I think that's your job as the GP. So I think if you see a woman aged 45 to 55 who comes in with insomnia or depression or something like that, if she doesn't raise the issue of the menopause, then I think it's your job as the GP to say, well, this could be the menopause, and then ask specifically about other menopausal symptoms, about her menstrual periods, about whether she's having flushes and sweats. Because you're quite right, I think women in deprived areas are less likely to raise these issues. And if we look at the prescribing data, women in deprived areas are less likely to be prescribed HRT. But I think it's the GP's job or the practice nurse's job to say, this could be the menopause. And then open up the conversation from there.
Sorry, forgive me. A lot of women won't present because they're not aware that this could be menopause and this is something that we could very easily treat.
But they present with other things, surely.
Not necessarily.
I mean, so if a woman of 45 comes to you and complains that she's not sleeping well, would you discuss with her the possibility that she may be menopausal? Because I would.
Potentially. But I suppose the question is about getting that knowledge into communities that traditionally don't have that knowledge so that they're better informed and they're able to really champion them their own.
Yes, but I don't know how you do that. How do you make women living in deprived communities better informed about the menopause? I mean, we're planning a publicity campaign about the menopause, which will take place next year. And we're having meetings to discuss how best to do it. There's a meeting this afternoon with the clinical reference group for the menopause network to get their advice on what would you include in a publicity campaign. I don't know how well publicity campaigns affect certain areas of society, certain stratas of the population. I suspect that you're more likely to be aware of these publicity campaigns if you're in less deprived areas than if you're running around looking after your kids and sorting out your problems with the cost of living. So I don't know what you would do. But I think it's the GP's job, when people do come to see them, to raise it as a possibility.
Thank you.
Ruth Maguire, very briefly.
Sorry, pressing my button as well, getting all flustered. I get a little bit concerned when we talk about women in deprived areas being less knowledgeable. And my experience as an MSP who represents some areas which are very economically deprived is that it's not about women's lack of knowledge or confidence, that it's just simply more challenging to interact with a system if you are an employee rather than self-employed, if you're in a low-income job or, as you said, have, you know, children to look after, different demands on your time. And I would just want to reflect, and I think you did in your answer, to be fair, that would be a kind of quite dangerous, lazy assumption for us to make if we're talking about women's health.
I think that's right. Like I say, I think if you're busy looking after 101 things, then maybe you don't take so much notice of your menopausal symptoms.
Professor Glazier, shortly after you came into the post, we had a cross-party group on endometriosis, if you remember that. So the Women's Health Plan has committed to reducing waiting times for diagnosing endometriosis from more than 8 years to less than 12 months by the end of the parliamentary term. Do you think that's achievable?
I hope it's achievable, but I know that there are long waiting lists for... To make a definitive diagnosis of endometriosis, you need to do a diagnostic laparoscopy because you need to see the endometriotic deposits. Most doctors are reluctant to submit people to a diagnostic laparoscopy because it involves a general anaesthetic. So you have to overcome that. But also there is, as you know, a long waiting list for people with gynecological conditions which aren't cancer. And whether that situation improves by the end of the parliamentary term, I don't know. I hope it does. And the Scottish Government is putting money into waiting list initiatives. So the answer is, I hope so. But we are planning a publicity campaign on endometriosis, and I met with the marketing people last week. And this is a publicity campaign for healthcare professionals, not for women. And they were asking me, what would be your single message to the healthcare practitioners? And I said, I think that listening to women with endometriosis talking about their experience, my single message would be 1 in 10 women have endometriosis. They would like to know that you're thinking about it as a possible diagnosis.
And it's the referral. So women are saying to me, they're just not being referred.
Yeah, I think it's the referral, but I think it's also important to explain to women, I'm suggesting this form of treatment because it is valuable in endometriosis. I think a lot of women, for example, feel that they're being fobbed off when GPs put them on the pill. Now, I'm a great proponent of the pill. I think the pill is a great treatment for things like heavy menstrual periods. If you take the pill continuously, you don't have periods, so you don't have dysmenorrhea. But I think GPs need to explain to women why they're putting them on the pill so that they don't feel fobbed off. And I think if women have symptoms suggestive of endometriosis, then healthcare professionals should tell them that they are considering the diagnosis of endometriosis and that they will refer them if their symptoms don't settle on the standard treatments.
And my follow-up question on endometriosis, Professor Glazier, is, as we know, there are an estimated 100,000 women living with endometriosis in Scotland. And according to Endometriosis UK, their view, based on the data, is the base level of care for this debilitating condition is currently not being met across Scotland. So what action would you propose that they take to actually improve the situation for all these women?
I think we need to work our way through the waiting list so that women wait less length of time before they're seen by a specialist with an interest in endometriosis.
And you've talked about heart health being the, almost the highest priority. Would you say that endometriosis comes a close second?
I wouldn't, no, because I don't think endometriosis is worse than many other conditions. I think we hear a lot about endometriosis because the people with endometriosis have done a very good job of getting their advocacy going. And so there is a national endometriosis society that is speaking very well for women with endometriosis. But I wouldn't put it just below heart disease. I might put breast cancer quite high up, ovarian cancer quite high up.
Although I'd just like to say the women who are talking to me and who shared with you at the CPG, debilitating pain, breakdown of relationships, including marriage, not being able to work. So having a lobby group is not because of the lobby group, it's because of the huge amount of issues these women are having.
I know, and I agree with that. And it's very moving hearing those people talking about their experiences with endometriosis. But it's not just women with endometriosis. I think there are a lot of conditions which make women's lives extremely difficult. And we should do better at tackling all of them. I think the difficult thing with endometriosis is that if it's a difficult condition to diagnose without doing surgery, and doctors try to avoid doing surgery because it involves a general anaesthetic and that takes time, and because there's a long waiting list for surgical procedures.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Karen Walken.
Thank you,
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I have been really interested in your reflections around working in a different way and attitudes to approaching women's health. It's very helpful to hear you talk about that. My question is around funding, and I suppose what I'm interested to know is if you have any reflections on how funding is used in terms of supporting women's health, whether the plan should have or did have enough funding attached to it, or if there's anything that you think we might have to fund to get it right, such as the training, etc., that you're talking about.
So of course I would say there isn't enough funding behind the Women's Health Plan. I'd be mad not to. Could we have some more money, please? That would be very nice. Let me give you an example. So long-acting reversible methods of contraception, IUDs and contraceptive implants. If we look at abortion rates, they've increased by 19%, so that's nearly a one in five, between 2021 and 2022, and it's likely that they'll go up more again this year. And we know that IUDs and implants are by far the most effective methods of contraception. They have failure rates of less than 1%, compared with the pill, which is 9%, condoms, which are 18%. They're also much more likely to be continued than the other methods because you have to go and see somebody to stop using them. So inertia acts in favour of continuation. But we know we're not nearly meeting the demand for long-acting reversible methods of contraception. We know that many GPs have stopped providing long-acting reversible methods, particularly IUDs, because they're overwhelmed. They don't have the capacity to do it. It takes three appointments plus the three appointments taken up by the assistant as well. So even although the method lasts for at least 5 years, and I would see that as a good investment of time, GPs faced with hordes of people coming in to be seen with 101 different conditions don't see it in the same light as I do. And we know that sexual and reproductive health services are not meeting the demand. So, yeah, we need more money for long-acting reversible methods of contraception.
Can I ask then, you know, how you're approaching that as the Women's Health Champion with the government? Have you spoken to them about where the funding might come to or where we might move money about? Or
so what we set up a short life working group to understand why we're not meeting the demand, to look at options for how to do things differently. So, for example, in a couple of health boards, people have looked at cluster arrangements where one GP who is skilled at inserting IUDs, and let's just talk about IUDs, one GP who's skilled at inserting IUDs and passionate about doing so provides a service for half a dozen different practices. And that works there. But all those initiatives that we've looked at have been funded by soft money and they depend on that one individual person, so they're not sustainable. So we've looked at, I've spoken to the people in St Andrew's House about the GP contract. This is probably a very unacceptable thing to say, but could we move money from the GPs who aren't doing LARC anymore to sexual health services so that they're providing LARC? I've been told that that can't happen. So I'm now just finalising a paper saying this is the bottom line. Health boards have to accept that if they want to reduce unintended pregnancies and abortion rates, they should fund LARC. And I'm going to tout that round everybody I can think of, the CMO, the deputy CMO, the National Clinical Director and the Minister, and try and put pressure on whoever so that boards fund it.
OK, thank you. Thanks very much. Now, to be a bit I'm interested in, you know, you talked about trying to train staff so that they approach women's health in the right way. Do you think there's enough finance in the system to do that in terms of primary care and GP practices?
Actually, I don't think that that is so much an issue of finance. Okay. I think that's an issue of thinking differently. Okay. And so if I give you another very brief example, so insertion of an IUD when somebody's just had a baby. So the best time, if somebody's decided they would like an IUD as a postpartum method of contraception, the best time to insert it is immediately after the baby's delivered. So baby out, placenta out, IUD in. I think it needs to be the responsibility of the person that's doing the delivery to put in the IUD, regardless of the mode of delivery. So if it's a consultant, they should put in doing a caesarean section, they should put in an IUD at the time of caesarean section. And they're doing that now in Scotland. We've achieved that. I think it's true to say that if you're a woman wanting an IUD as an immediate postpartum contraceptive, it will be done if you have an elective caesarean section. We're not quite so good at doing it immediately after a forceps delivery or a Bontoose, and we're very bad at doing it after a spontaneous vaginal delivery. What we need is for the midwives, the College of Midwives, to put IUD insertion on the curriculum for midwives in training. So that's not money, that's getting people to think differently about what our responsibilities are for women's health.
Okay.
And I think, you know, getting GPs to ask questions of women aged 45, do you have any menopausal symptoms? It's getting people to think differently.
Lovely. Thanks very much for your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Tess White.
Thank you. Can I ask, please, about one in five women will experience perinatal mental health problems. And while suicide is tragically the leading cause a maternal death in the first year after a baby's birth, would you support perinatal mental health being addressed as a priority in the next women's health plan?
I think I would need to discuss it with the stakeholders with whom we're going to have discussions, because I think, personally, I think it probably sits better in the maternity plan than in the women's health plan, because it's all part of maternity. So unless we amalgamate maternity and women's health, which I'm not sure would be a good idea. So I'd need to discuss it with whoever we're going to discuss the next iteration of the plan with. But I suspect it's better staying in maternity.
And do you think we need better support and more support for
perinatal
health? Thank you. And too many women have described to me the dismissive way they've been treated and are being treated by clinicians. It's almost as though it's a culture. From the and it goes from menopause to endometriosis. We had several serious examples in relation to transvaginal mesh scandal, and they aren't believed, and their mental health is impacted as a result of that. So have you seen any of this, or are you being told about any of this dismissive culture? And if you have, is there anything that can be done about it?
Well, you know, I went to the group on endometriosis, and you hear about it there. But I have to say that you only hear from people who are unhappy with the way that they've been treated. I only hear from people who are unhappy with the way they've been treated. I don't hear from the people who are happy with the way that they've been treated. And that's always how it is. You hear from a very small, very biased sample. And I think it colours your view, and I don't think that the majority of doctors are dismissive. I think the majority of doctors and nurses and everybody else in the NHS does their absolute utmost to provide a really good service. And sometimes individuals are unhappy with the service that they've received. Sometimes individuals don't hit it off with their healthcare provider, but I actually think, and maybe the GP on the committee would agree with me, that people do their best, and that people who are very unhappy with their care are very much in the minority. I'm sure we're all unhappy with having to phone at 8:30 in the morning to try and get an appointment. But when we are seen, I think the majority of us are happy with the care that we get.
Possibly.
He wasn't listening.
Thank you, convener, and thanks to the panel for their comments so far. I've got particular concern about the decrease in drugs deaths in 2022, because I note that this was far greater in males, and there's evidently particular issues with women who use drugs that the rate isn't decreasing at quite the same level. Do you have any view about why that might be the case and what might be done?
I'm not an expert in drug abuse. I mean, you know, I read the papers, but it's not something. I would have to defer to the people who are working in that area. I don't think I can say anything helpful on that. I mean, you know, we recognise in the Women's Health Plan that that women's health, everybody's health, is intersectional. And there are a lot of things going on in people's lives, but that's not my area.
Okay. Do you have any comments, either?
No, I don't think we'd want to add to okay. Professor Clayton said, but obviously it goes without saying, convener, if there's any issues that come up during the session that you think engage government policy, obviously we can provide some clarification in writing if that helps.
Okay. Audit Scotland told the Public Audit Committee in September that the Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan, which prioritised women and girls' mental health, did not outline timescales for the actions, and a review of progress has not been carried out. Professor Glazer, is this something that is on your radar as Women's Health Champion, and do you support calls for further detail on delivery and evaluation?
What was the last bit? Do I support?
Do you support calls for further detail on delivery and evaluation?
Of mental health?
Yeah.
In general, yes. I think the Women's Health Plan recognises, as I say, that mental health impacts on women's health and that women's health impacts on mental health. And we know that menstrual problems and that menopause affect women's health. And through the Women's Health Plan, through those specific issues and actions in the Women's Health Plan, we're trying to deal with that.
Okay. You mentioned that you didn't have a particular locus in drug deaths.
No.
Do you have a particular locus on alcohol-related deaths in
nope,
women?
No, I don't.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Doesn't appear in the Women's Health Plan.
Okay.
We're moving on to the next theme, Mr Sweeney, which I believe you've got questions on.
Indeed, do indeed. As a former member of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee, we quite regularly received a number of public petitions that relate to women's health. There are petitions at the moment on smear test age, fertility treatment and abortion currently being considered by the committee. Professor Glazer, what are you doing to ensure that women's concerns about issues like those raised by petitioners through the Public Petitions Committee are being held by the Scottish Government, the National Health Service and local government?
So, as you know, we're doing a lot of work in abortion, smears and infertility isn't in the Women's Health Plan, but I know that there's a group that are looking at infertility services. So I think there's a lot going on, and I certainly meet quite regularly with the abortion team, and I'm very interested in hearing what's going on with the work on late abortions, on safe access zones, and hopefully at some point on decriminalisation of abortion. Mm. So I think actually the Scottish Government is pretty responsive to those topics.
Mm-hmm. That's helpful. Do you have any engagement with those petitions at the moment?
Not specifically with the petitions, but I'm certainly working quite closely, particularly with the abortion team, because that's something that I have had a lot of experience with and have done a lot of research in the past. And so that and contraception overlap significantly with the current Women's Health Plan.
Mm, okay. Our last evidence session was on remote and rural healthcare, and it's clear that there are inequalities in accessing healthcare in Scotland on a geographical basis, but also on socioeconomic background. What does the Women's Health Champion do to raise awareness of health inequalities and ultimately reduce them?
Well, I think we discuss them in everything we talk about. And so, for example, in our menstrual health network, clinical network, in our menopause clinical network, in with the women's health leads. We wave the women's health plan at them, which discusses inequalities, and we talk to them about their awareness of inequalities on women's health. And as I've told you at the beginning, we have this proposal to do a pilot study in the deep end practices to see if we can do better with having a more holistic approach to women's health and more expertise in women's health taken to women in those areas of inequalities. Mm. So I think we're trying hard.
Mm. That's helpful. There has recently been a debate in the Scottish Parliament on protecting an award-winning neonatal unit in University Hospital Wishaw, and there are concerns about a lack of consultation prior to the decision being made on downgrading the unit, particularly mothers being separated from their premature babies. What can we do to ensure the voices of local women who have these deep and very emotional concerns and upsetting concerns are consulted on decisions that impact them in a very, very intense and very visceral way?
Well, again, I would say that, you know, I'm not concerned with the day-to-day work of the maternity plan or issues in neonatal units. I mean, clearly it is an issue, and I'm sure that their voices are being heard, but I really can't comment on that.
OK.
I need to move on.
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. I think some of the questions have been already covered regarding implementation and evaluation, and I'm just looking at the interim progress report from August 2023, which covers progress, obviously.
Yeah.
So I'm interested in, you know, where do you see the implementation and then the evaluation as we go forward? I know you're doing quarterly blogs, and how important is it to communicate the progress, because there is a lot going on, and I think it's amazing. There's so many subjects, just looking at the petitions committee and things like that. So I'd be interested to hear how important you think it is to make sure that progress is communicated so that people know what's been achieved.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. And I think we do need to make people aware of the progress that's being made. And I think we need to make healthcare providers aware too, because we hear all the time that people are demoralised, and I think demoralisation is a self-fulfilling prophecy. So whenever I meet with groups, you know, I always emphasise the positive and say, for example, we've got a meeting this afternoon with the menopause team, the menopause network reference group. So we're going to review what have we achieved in the last year, what do we hope to achieve in the next year, and I think we need to congratulate them on what we've achieved, because we've achieved a lot.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there's a role for us in, as MSPs, in our social media connectivity? Sometimes social media is not the best platform for communicating things, but I think it could be used in a different, a more positive way, if we have a way to support good communication. I was at an event in Dumfries and Galloway recently where Dr. Heather Curry spoke to 100 women in the room about menopause, yeah. And she is a total champion,
yeah,
for communication and understanding what is the menopause all about, and destigmatising as well. So do you think there's a role that we can help in communicating as well?
Yeah, I think there is, and it would be great if you said some nice things about how well the Women's Health Plan is going. It would also be great if you kept reminding people about NHS Inform, mm-hmm, and that whenever they've got a health condition that they want to find out about, not to go to Google, but to go to NHS Inform, mm-hmm, so they get accurate information. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think it would be really great if you could be positive about the Women's Health Plan.
And just... OK, right, happy.
My apologies. And finally, a supplementary from Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. I was struck by something you said earlier, Professor Glazier, about that intersectionality versus the siloed way that the NHS often works. And given your priorities are naturally chunked out into three large pieces, how do you see those working across each other? You used the example earlier of women who have PCOS are at, yeah, higher risk of heart disease. They're also at higher risk of diabetes and things. And quite often, once you're diagnosed, you're given tablets, which have wonderful side effects, and are then left without any other form of follow-up. Is that, are those crossovers things that are actively being looked at by yourself and the team, and how is progress going on some of those areas?
Yes, they are. And early on, soon after I started, the team and I went to Aberdeen to meet with Grampian Health Board. And as you know, you might know, Grampian in Aberdeen, they're going to open a new hospital next year. The Baird Family Hospital, and speaking then to the non-executive director, she said, we really want to do things differently. Mm-hmm. So we've been having discussions with them and discussions with the Professor of Obstetrics and Gynaecology there, and putting them in touch with Chest, Heart and Stroke, mm-hmm, Scotland. So, for example, I've said to them, why don't you, in your waiting area of your nice new shiny hospital, which sees a lot of women, have a women's health information hub where you could check people's blood pressure, you could even take blood for cholesterol, you could talk to them about osteoporosis. All of this could be done with volunteers from Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland. It doesn't have to cost the NHS money. So, yeah, I think it's terribly important that we try and broaden our horizons and the way we look at health in general, but for us, at women's health in particular.
That's great. Thanks, Kamina.
Thank you. And can I thank Professor Glazer and the officials that have joined her today for their evidence. At our meeting next week, we'll be continuing our inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas, hearing from academics with expertise in rural healthcare. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.